And I'm going to read a scripture. Well, this is based on the theme that I'm going with is commitment. In Genesis 29, verse 14, I'm going to start off with verse 14. It says, Then Laban said to him, and we're talking about Jacob here, because Jacob began to work for his uncle Laban. He said to him, thank you, worship team. He says, you are my own flesh and blood. And after Jacob has stayed with him for a whole month, after working with him for a month, Laban said to him, just because you are a relative of mine, you should work for me for nothing. Tell me your wages, what your wages should be. Now Laban had two daughters, and the name of the older one was Leah, and the name of the younger one was Rachel. Let me pray so we can go ahead and start our service. Lord Heavenly Father, we come before you, Father, tonight, united, Father, as a church, Father, Lord Jesus, asking that you be with us, Father, tonight, Father, Lord. I ask that you bless everyone here tonight, Father, Lord. And Lord, I ask that you allow each and every single one of us here to dissect the word, Father, Lord, and allow us to see ourselves, Father, in this word, Father, and to ask our own questions of our own commitment, Father, and love, Father, that we have. Remember that we are here because of you, Father, Lord Jesus. Lord, I ask that you allow these words to go home with them, Father, and that they live them to the fullest and committed way, Father, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me continue reading here. You can have a seat. Sorry. Welcome to not here. Laban is talking to Jacob here. And Jacob had already been working for Laban, his uncle, for a month. And this month had already passed. And him and they're having a conversation. They're just like, well, you can't work here for free. You know, tell me what is it that you want. And then again, the scripture tells us that Laban had two daughters. The older one was Leah, and the younger one was Rachel. The scripture says that Leah was tender-eyed. She was weak. One of her eyes was lazy. You couldn't see where she was looking at. She was cross-eyed. And then it tells us that Rachel was beautiful. She had a gorgeous body. And she was just a beautiful person. Now, throughout the time that Jacob was working for Laban, he had seen Rachel at the well. And right then and there, he fell in love with her. And he wanted her. It was just, man, this is the person that I want to be with. This is the person that I want to marry. Jacob fell in love. On verse 18, it says, Jacob was in love with Rachel and says, I'll work for you for 7 years in return for your younger daughter, Rachel. And Laban said, it's better that I give her to you than to some other man. Stay here with me. So Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel. But they seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife. My time is complete. I want to make love to her. So the point of the scripture is Jacob's commitment to Laban as a worker, to someone who's dedicated to his job. And because he ultimately wanted the gold prize, which was Rachel. Now, you know, I want to go back and just read that verse. He says, Jacob was in love with Rachel and said to Laban, I'll work for you for 7 years in return for your daughter. And, you know, and that's a long time. That's a long time for some of us to stay committed for something that we can't even have yet. And sometimes it's hard for us to even work 7 days for our wives now. You know, it's hard for us to commit but Jacob's commitment was for 7 years. 7 years. So finally, he does his whole time. He does this time for Laban. And he tells him, okay, all right, my 7 years is up. All right, Laban, go ahead and let me have Rachel. Let's get it on. And they throw a big, huge party, a huge barbecue. I mean, they cook out, they bring all the neighbors and everybody, you know, they bring all the barbacoa and probably had menudo. And you know, they throw a feast for him because, you know, it was a marriage for one of Laban's daughters and Jacob. And I'm sure, you know, they were drinking. So finally, when Jacob goes to his room and it's time for the daughter to go to his room, one of the daughters goes in there and he makes love to her. But in the morning, he wakes up to find out that it was Leah. And he's just like, he wakes up and he's like, wait a minute. This is not the one that I chose. I didn't pick this one. This one's ugly. She's cross-eyed. No, I don't want this one. So he gets up in the morning and he goes to Laban and says, hey, you know, you manipulated me here. I worked for you for 7 years for Rachel, and you gave me Leah. And Laban's reply is, well, I'm sorry for your luck, but it's not our custom for us to give our younger one before we give the older one. So why don't you just finish your commitment with Leah, and then why don't you come back and work for another 7 years, and I'll give you the younger one too. So he decides that he's going to go ahead and work for 7 more years. 14 years he worked for Rebecca. Mm-hmm. And throughout this time that he was married, he was still married to Leah. Leah, he didn't love her, but he still was playing the role of the husband. You know, he was still committed to that. And Leah, more importantly, she was in a situation where she wasn't even loved. She wasn't even wanted. And God knew that she wasn't even loved and that Jacob didn't want her. And she felt the insecurity of not being loved. She felt the need of being loved. She was just like, well, maybe if I give Jacob a son, he'll love me. So she had Simeon. And then, well, you know, he still didn't love her, so she had another one. And his name was Reuben. And still, she couldn't feel love from Jacob. So then she gave him another one, Levi. And still, Jacob really could not love her, but she was still committed on finding the love that she wanted from Jacob. And so she gave him a fourth child. And so And after she had the last child, she says, okay, finally, now I'm done. Now I will fully serve the Lord. You know, let me go back to my notes here. After Leah had her fourth child, she says, now I will praise the Lord. After she had realized that she had been conceiving only for people to love her, she finally put away those insecurities, the intimidations, trying to please others. And she finally decided to finally give God her all. Now, see, in a situation like that, you have to realize your misery to see where God needs you to change. And then you have to commit to those things that you have to change into. So until you see yourself sometimes, like the jóvenes or the young adults, when you're out there, and you know, I know from experience, because I did it weekly, I did it all the time. And it was just, you know, I would go out drinking. And after that, I would, you know, I would do this, my sinful things. And at the end of the night, I still felt empty. I still felt empty. But it wasn't until finally I couldn't do it anymore. I said, you know what, God, I just can't do this anymore. And when I finally gave my life to God, I said, God, you know, I need you to change my life completely, because the way that I'm living right now, I'm living in a misery right now where nothing satisfies me, nothing fulfills my heart with what I need. And so, Lord, I need you to sit on my heart and make it your throne, and then make it your home. And so finally, you know, God started making those transformations, but I have to learn how to stay committed to God. It wasn't just I go out and just say, all right, God, I'm here this Sunday. All right, I need you to bless me with a job. And then go out next Saturday and then live a simple life. And then be right back on Sunday and say, hey, God, forgive me for what I did last night. You know, I had to learn how to stay committed to God's word, to his preachings. Now, if we go back to some of the, you know, some of the children that Leah had, Simeon, her first child, the meaning of Simeon means hears and obeys. You know, some people come to church. They come to church, but they don't hear what the pastor's preaching. We don't listen to what God actually has to say to us because we're not committed. And then we come to church, but we're not hearing what God has to say. And when we don't hear what God has to say, we don't even have faith. You know, the word of God says that having faith is what?
Hearing.
And God blessed her with Simeon, which means hears and obeys. And then her third son, his name was Levi. That means joined, connected, committed. You know, every single one of her children has a meaning. And if you take those meanings, those are the examples of what we need to live by. You know, Levi means staying committed, staying connected with God. You know, and that's what we have to put those these rules, the God's words in our own lives. Not only in church, but it's also a commitment to have a friendship. You know, I was talking to Christy when we went to Dallas, and I was just like, did you know that being committed having a friendship is like a job. You know, you gotta stay committed to a friend. And sometimes it's hard to have friends because, you know, we live a busy life. We have family, we have church, there's work, there's so much, there's kids, there's just so much to do. And having a friendship is being committed. Oh, Sonner, you have to, it's hard to have a friendship where what if I can't pick up a call? What if I can't text you back? It takes a commitment to have a friendship. It takes a commitment to have a marriage. It takes a commitment to be in church. It takes a commitment to have a relationship with God. You know? And I'm gonna jump around here because what we're gonna do, I'm gonna invite some people here to join us here in a minute. And some of us, we don't live that way. Some of us just want a lot of the benefits, but none of the responsibilities. You know, and again, I live that way. You know, we have the ceremonies, we have the weddings, but we're not married. You know, they get a marriage certificate. We're not married. Because at the first wind that you, when something goes wrong, one of them wants to leave. Oh, this ain't for me. I don't have to deal with this. I can go stay at my parents' house. I'm already at my parents' house. One of them wants to just get up and say, they say, this isn't working for me. We go through the actions of commitment, but don't stick through the actions to stay committed. You know? Because we have no understanding in what a relationship is. You know, and this is one thing that I picked up and I've been kind of exercising on my wife here. You cannot have a relationship without reciprocity. You can't get into a relationship to get and not give. Yeah. You ask yourself, now ask yourself this. Do you give as good as you get? Do you?
No. If you're honest, no. You get lazy.
Yeah. It becomes a me relationship. It's all about me. What about me? So you have to have the reciprocity in a relationship, and if you think about it, it's what God gives. God is constantly giving. He gave the ultimate price. He gave His only Son for our life, so that we can have eternal life in heaven. Now I think just me being here, we owe Him a lot. So we got to give Him our all. So we got to stay committed. Take a job, for instance, your work. You take a job to get paid. You're there for money, right? Well, everybody wants some money. Everybody wants some money, right? We're there for a check. That's it. We're there just for a check. But that's why it's not going to work. Because we're just there to receive. What are you giving? What are you giving your job? I had to, you know, this past month or so, I've been kind of just reestablishing myself at my job. I went through a period where it was just kind of like pure negativity at work, and I was feeling down. I was feeling frustrated, and I got to the point where I was just, you know, I'm just there to get paid. I wasn't giving it my all, but I had to change my mentality, and I have to give it my all. They brought me there for a purpose. Now I gotta show it. Now I gotta show my commitment. I was telling Christy, I was just like, man, babe, I need to be more grateful for the job that I have. It's a long drive, but it pays the bills. It, you know, it helps put food in our mouth. I like to eat a lot. And so we have to understand the reciprocity. If you're not willing to give as good as you get, you won't last because you're not committed. And then you get to a point where you live your life in a what if situation. What if I would have given my all to that job? What if I would have given my all to my marriage? How better would it be if I would have given my all in the beginning? How much better would it have come out? Where would I be if I would have given my job everything that I had? Probably be running my own bank right now. But I'm not, because I haven't given it my all. And right now, I think they're kind of just waiting to see what I have. Amen. And so now I need to show them my commitment. Now I need to give them my all. And just like God isn't a genie. And I've said this before. You don't just ask God to bless you for your blessings and just, hey, I want. Now you gotta give it to God. You gotta give him your praise. You gotta give him your worship. You gotta give him thanks. Even when things aren't going right or things don't go in the order that you want them to, you gotta give thanks to God. You know what? I didn't get that raise, but thank you, God. I have a job. Man, my car is not acting right, but I got one. I gotta be thankful for the things that I have. I have a roof over my home. I wouldn't have one, but I do. You know, I need to learn to be more grateful for my marriage. I have a wife who makes sure that I stay in line. You know? There's not a lot of people that can say that. And I'm grateful for that. But then without this reciprocity, you live your life in a what if situation. Goes with your marriage. Are you giving as good as you get in your marriage? And the same thing about in church. Are you giving as good as you get in church? You know, there's more members that aren't here today. Why? I don't know. What are they asking themselves? Is the pastor going to preach tonight? Or is Stephen? I mean, you're there to receive the word. Right? But because the pastor's not preaching, they don't come. They're not giving their all to the church. They're not giving their all to God. Oh, I'm not going to go because he's preaching English. It's the same message. We all go to work. So you got to give to the church. Because you're getting something from the church. You're getting a message from the church. You're getting a message from God. Commitment. Imagine if you gave yourself and you give it all that you have. And like I said earlier, there's the commitment, it goes from school, it goes to school. And I haven't even talked about that. Some kids just want to pass, they want to pass a grade, but they don't want to study. They want all the benefits, they want to graduate, but they don't want to work for it. And the system has created a rule where it's called, what is it called? No child left behind. That means everyone's going to graduate no matter what. If you're the age of 21 and you're still in the second grade, you're going to graduate. You're not working for it. You just want the benefits. It's a commitment. People hide behind their talents because they can't be committed. Oh man, that he can play the drums, but he's not committed. And so they use their talent to hide behind it because they can't be committed because their talents are so good. It's all a commitment. And if I was a boss at an employer, I would rather have someone who's committed than someone who has a master's degree, speaks 7 languages, and yet they're not committed to come to work and give me all they got. If they're not committed, then I don't want them. I'd rather have someone who's got guts, who's got stamina to stay, to work, to earn their check, versus someone who can't, and they think they're better because they got this knowledge. Well, I'm glad you graduated, but what are you doing? You're not doing anything. There's lots of people who've got many degrees, and they're not doing anything. They can't even find a job. People at McDonald's make more than them. Not to disrespect anybody working at McDonald's. And they don't even have a degree. You know, like I said, there's people that want all the benefits of having the job. Money. There are people who want sex in marriage, but they don't want to be a spouse. They don't want to be a husband. They don't want to be a wife. They don't want all the responsibilities that come in a marriage. They don't want to pay the bills, but they want the check. Women want a husband, but they don't want to be a wife. You're not a wife. You're just a girl who wants a man. No, and they'll end up saying, when things go a little bad, oh, I can't beat myself. You shouldn't have gotten married. If you want to be yourself, no, it's a commitment. It's a job. It's work. It's a commitment. You know, and even when you made that choice to get married, the pastor who was asking you and was telling you, you know, before you do this, are you willing to stick this through sickness and health, through, you know, rich or poor, through the thick and thin? Do you want to really do this? I mean, he was asking you for a reason. He knew one of you was going to be crazy. You know? Now you got to show your commitment because you said, I do. Right?
Yeah.
You know, but we have to show the commitment in on all areas of our lives. And that's even as parents. You can't have kids and just let them run around doing whatever they want. No, you gotta be after them. You want to raise them right? Raise them right. I'm sorry, but I'm a believer in the belt.
I am.
Ask my kids. Noah gets in trouble. God, yeah. He already knows.
Yeah.
You know? Even Gio and Charlie. They get in trouble too. I'm a believer. I'm sorry, I'm committed. They probably think it's bad, or some people think, hey, you need to take it easy on the kids. No, I need to be on the kids so that they go straight. Some people say, well, they fear you. Well, don't we gotta fear God? We have to fear God for our consequences, for our actions. You either, when you make right decisions, He blesses you. Bad decisions, there's consequences for it. But I'm after my kids because I don't want them acting a mess. I don't want them acting bad. I don't want them doing wrong. You know, I mentioned it to the church before. I'm having trouble with Noah. He's getting to the age where he's becoming a teen. He's acting like a teenager now. So I gotta give him a little attention as far as, you know, you need to start learning how to act right. I gotta be behind him. And I don't have him here, but when I do, you know, I'm behind him. I may have to yell at him and get his attention, but I made a commitment that I'm gonna try to raise my kids as good as I can. I'm gonna try to raise my kids how my parents raised me. They installed the Word of God in me. I made my choices. But right now, he's still young enough to where I can still install God's Word in him. And that's a commitment. If you don't want commitment with your kids, then you shouldn't have had it. But the commitment in this love series, it goes a long ways. And like I said, it's evolved all around of our lives. From friendships to school, to work, church, your marriage, God, your job. It's all a commitment. Are you committed? And if you're committed, do you give as good as you get? Do you? Now, I'd like to invite, I want to invite Audrey and Cruz. They're going to join us here tonight. And so we like what we did last time with the pastors, where we asked them some questions about, we hit different areas with them. We hit different areas of their marriage. And then today we're gonna hit some topics of regarding commitment, because commitment is, like I said, it's probably the most important thing in life. And so we prepared some questions here that we're gonna ask them, and they're gonna give us our input.
Before you continue, I was writing some notes. People who can't commit, they have a feeling of inadequacy and insufficiency. And that's in every aspect of life. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we can't commit to God because we fear that he wants more than what we can give, so we feel insufficient. In a marriage, people can feel that too, because they're like, well, you know what, they deserve better than me, so I'm gonna mess this up, and I can't commit because you deserve better than I do. And so their feelings of inadequacy and insufficiency. People who can't commit have friends with benefits.
That's true.
That's very true. They have commitment issues, so they have friends with benefits. They can't ever label something. They can't call it what it is because there's nothing there. Mm-hmm. You're dragging people by and you're wasting their time.
Yeah.
And when we have friends with benefits, we take on a parasitic lifestyle or character. A parasite, what a parasite does is it takes like a leech. It sucks the blood out of its host.
Yeah.
It's just sucking the life out of it. Just sucking the life and sucking the life until it eventually kills its host. Because it's taken everything from it.
Yeah.
And a leech never gives a return.
That's right.
It's a parasite.
Reciprocity.
That's right.
You got it right.
That's right.
But we take on a parasitic lifestyle or character, and we take and take and take, and we never give a return. And so in our marriage, I have to check myself before I wreck myself. And because he's a giver. God has given him an amazing ability to bless people, to give. And I have to check myself sometimes. Am I giving what he's giving me?
Yeah.
And sometimes it's not.
Yeah, and that's one thing that, when God finally took ownership in my heart, that's one thing that I learned to do. You know, I never was someone, my relationships were always just about me. And that's just the way I live. Even in the beginning of my relationship with Christy, it was just about me. But it wasn't until I fully found God and he fully took over my heart and mind where he showed me how to give. And it's like it's like the, you know, the love languages of love, you know, God's love is agape love. He gives and gives and gives. And I find myself now giving. I find myself, I love my wife. I do. Thank you. But she does a lot. She does a lot for me. But the fact is that I like to give now. And it wasn't until I got the love of Christ in my heart to where it was a God love. Yeah.
I'm always really quiet. When he was talking about our relationship in the beginning, he wasn't like what he is right now. I mean, he was kind of super mean to me, and I'm just being honest.
Me too. He was mean to me too.
Girl, we're gonna beat him up in the parking lot later. Well, I remember one day I was at work, and my mentor, Lisa, we had like appointments almost every day in the bathroom because I had to go cry because Stephen made me cry again. And it wasn't a lot because of the commitment thing. And I just remember I was in there, and I mean, I've known Stephen since I was like 19 or 20 years old. I'm 33 right now. And I've known him since I was 19, and you know, we lost track with each other or whatever. But I remember one of the days, and this stuck out to me, and it helped me so much because we had our daily meetings or weekly meetings in the bathroom, and my friend Lisa was like, Christy, I mean, she was just so sick of it. You know, she was telling me, you need to leave him, you know, he's not gonna change, and you know, yada, yada, yada. But I just had like this little smidge of hope that he was finally going to get right, you know? And she finally told me this, and this helped me so much. She told me that, Stephen would never love or be committed to me until he loved and was committed to God. That he wouldn't know love at all because he still didn't know the love of God. And like that helped me so much, and like with the stop, it's not you, because Stephen didn't know what love was. How was he gonna love me if he didn't know what love was? Yeah. He didn't know the love of God. He didn't know any of that. And it was to that point where my knees were bleeding from being on my knees and praying to God, change him. So, you know, just change his ways. And in my closet crying and crying and crying until my eyes were just shut, closed, and praying over him and praying over him and having my friends pray over Steven for him to change. And it wasn't until she said that it clicked that, man, it's not me. I'm doing everything I'm supposed to be doing. It's him. He needs to know the love of God and be committed to God, because he wouldn't be able to be committed to me. And now, oh my gosh, he is like amazing. I know God's love because of how Stephen loves me, because he displays it. Like, you wouldn't even believe the nice, just little, even small things. Like last weekend, this is just something so dumb, but it was just so sweet and was so dumb, but meant a lot to me. Last weekend, you know, we had gone out of town, and the people we were with had a cat. And I had woke up the day before, and it was four of us in the bed. It was, you know, my youngest son, Caleb, and, you know, Charlotte, me, Steven, in this big old bed. And so in the morning, the day before, I had got up really early in the morning. I went to go capture that cat, and I brought him to bed, and I woke up Caleb and Charlotte, and they were like, oh, the cat's here! And they were so excited. And so the next day after that, and so the next day after that, Steven, well, I was asleep, and then he went to go look for it, and the cat actually attacked him and was like, get away from me, and he was just like, arr! But he still wanted to bring him to me, so me and the kids were asleep, and he goes and he brings me the cat, and I mean, he was all scratched up, but he knew that would have meant something to me, because I love animals, and he went and he doesn't. I don't know. Do you like cats? I don't know. Well, I don't know. I don't think you like them now. You used to. But you know, just sweet little things like that. And sometimes when I'm just thinking about how good he is to me now, I'm just kind of like, man, if this is how much Stephen can love me, like, how much more can God love me? Which is a love that I will never comprehend. The love of God is something that we can't even fathom. Like, it's something so grand and big that we can't even, I mean, he invented love, so I can't even imagine the kind of love that he has for me. And if I'm just seeing like a little, like just a little bit of it from what my husband gives me, you know, I can't even imagine, and that's what I have to say about that.
Cruz, when we were, it was a couple weeks ago for the Super Bowl party, when we were, this is something I admire, and what Audrey says, you know, you have a giving heart. And you do. You give to the church, you give to strangers. And you were telling me that story about the waitress, you know, how you tipped her, you know, so much more. I'm still in the process of you know, I think God is working on that part of me, learning how to be humble and giving. But you know, you do have a giving heart. How do you do it?
Teach us your ways.
I'm gonna speak a little bit in Spanish, that way I can kind of both ways.
I'm sorry, I have Salvadorian Spanish, and y'all probably wouldn't understand it.
Lo que le estaba explicando a Esteban hace como, what was it, like maybe a month ago?
No,
it was Super Bowl. So what was it?
2 weeks ago.
Okay, hace como dos, tres semanas. Le digo a Andrew que cuando nos juntamos nosotros, yo conocía así como un amor más verdadero de lo que tenía antes, como con las novias y todo eso. Pero cuando de veras conocí a Dios, conocí un amor más puro. Un amor puro que ni Audrey lo puede llenar.
Amén.
You know, and le digo que estaba tan bendecido como con todo lo que nos ha dado Dios, con tantas bendiciones, que le digo a Steven que hasta cuando no tengo yo, todos mundo quiero dar hasta lo que yo no tengo. Y eso es nomás lo que yo siento en mi corazón. Y le digo a Audrey que cuando pues, estábamos más o menos con las finanzas, y le dije a Audrey, ¿sabes qué? Hemos querido hacer muchas cosas con eso. Y le dije, cuando salgamos a comer, y no quiero bendecir a los meseros. Le dije, nomás con algo tan chico como le dije que dándole un poquito más de $2-3 que le dejamos cada vez a alguien ahí. Y le dije que que fuimos a comer aquí al Fun Patch. Y este, y estaba ayudándole a Malaquía, estábamos este, coloreando unos papeles que tienen ahí. Y la mesera, y no era bien buena gente, nos atendió muy bien. Y antes de que nos fuéramos, le dije a Malaquía, ¿sabes qué? Préstame tu color. Y ya me lo prestó. Y agarré una servilleta. Y en la servilleta le puse gracias en inglés y le puse God bless you. Y así, y le metí uno de 20 en la servilleta y ya nomás lo guardé. Y lo dejé así. Y cuando vino la muchacha, me dejó el recibo. Y yo le di en cambio pues la servilleta. Y como que me miró así medio, you know, pues ya me voy a llevar la basura. le dije, no, pues. Y nomás lo miró y se me quedó mirando. Y luego ya me dio el recibo. Y yo agarré el recibo. Y me fijé en el recibo y decía, God bless you. Entonces ella me lo escribió antes que yo se lo escribiera a ella. Y le dije a Audrey, le dije, mira, you know, ella, porque no sé si ella miró lo que había escrito, y este, y le enseñé, y en eso, pues ya nomás volteé a mirar a la muchacha que se había ido, pues se juntó en la puerta con las otras muchachas, que pues ya ves que cada vez andan todas las muchachas juntas en el Cotton Patch, y allí abrió la servilleta y miró que lo que yo puse, y cuando miró eso, le dije a Audrey que hasta parecía que como que ella quería llorar, y nomás se sintió así, se agarró la servilleta y hasta le enseñó a sus amigas, y nomás apuntó hacia la mesa y le dije, you know, algo tan pequeño como lo que hacemos, algo diferente de la rutina, así es una bendición nomás para ella, pero abre los ojos todos los de las más gentes alrededor de ellas.
Sí, amén.
You know, y le digo, no es algo que a mí me gusta como contarle a la gente lo que yo hago, las cosas chiquitas que, así como dice Steven, you know, porque no, como te digo, no me quiero sentir como que ando haciendo una gran cosa. Yo quiero hacer cosas aunque sepa o no sepa la gente, porque eso es lo que yo tengo en el corazón, no es porque quiero que la gente me mire de una manera. You know? Es muy difícil explicar así como qué es lo que yo tengo en el corazón, así, pero nomás te puedo decir que Dios es el que me da ese, no sé si sería don o ese deseo de dar. Y aunque no tenga, te digo, yo quiero dar, yo quiero seguir dando. Y aunque no sea con, you know, con dinero, sería con, pues con amor, you know. Y pues ahí es donde, como dice Steven, ahí lo agarro, desde Dios, no es de mí.
Dios.
Antes de seguir adelante, quería leer unos versos. Si pueden ir conmigo a Efesios 5, 5:21, nomás que lo voy a leer en inglés porque lo tengo en inglés. Es Efesios 5:21. Y dice, and further, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. For wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For a husband is head of his wife, as Christ is head of the body, head of the church. He is savior of his body, the church. As the church submits to Christ, so your wives should submit to your husbands in everything. For husbands, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life for her to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. He did this to present to himself as a glorious church without a spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love for himself. No one hates his own body, but feeds and cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church, and we are members of his body.
Si
lo pueden, por favor, leer en español.
Someteos unos a otros en el amor de Dios. Las casadas estén sujetas a sus propios maridos, como al Señor, porque el marido es cabeza de la mujer, así como Cristo es cabeza de la iglesia, la cual es su cuerpo y él es su salvador. Así que como la iglesia está sujeta a Cristo, así también las casadas lo estén a sus maridos en todo. Maridos, amar a vuestras mujeres, así como Cristo amó a la iglesia y se entregó a sí mismo por ella, para santificarla, habiéndola purificado en el lavamiento del agua por la palabra, a fin de presentársela a sí mismo una iglesia gloriosa, que no tuviese mancha ni arruga, ni cosa semejante, sino que fuese santa y sin mancha.
Amén.
Gloria
a Dios.
Do you want
anything else to input? Well, let me just throw a question out here that's not written. How do you guys deal with when you do have an issue in your marriage?
as far as this is going
coming at it with the commitment perspective. How do you guys deal with disagreements?
Dice okay. Steven que cómo le hacemos cuando estamos discutiendo, nos peleamos o algo así. Yeah, estamos de desacuerdo. Y le digo a Audrey, pues que se salga de la casa, que entra. No, le digo que tengo otra. No, le digo que
he's working on getting kicked out, guys.
Cuando estábamos un poquito más jóvenes. Era como, como hace como unos 2-3 años, le dije, Adriana, le dije, ¿sabes qué? Le dije, ya no somos novios, le dije, ahora ya somos esposo y esposa. Le dije, de aquí para adelante, pase lo que pase, necesitamos que averiguarlo entre nosotros. Le dije, ya no es tiempo de... Es que hay muchas veces que la primera cosa que hacemos es queremos buscar a alguien como, ¿cómo se dice? A respaldarnos. Así como alguien que caer atrás, que nos soporte, nos apoye en nuestra opinión. Entonces, si yo digo que yo estoy bien, yo estoy buscando a alguien que diga que sea algo, de acuerdo conmigo. Y es la misma cosa con ella. Le digo, Audrey, ya no podemos caer atrás que con mamá y papá y decirles, mira, me está tratando así o me anda diciendo esto y quién sabe cuál otro. Le dije, ahora no, ahora es entre tú y yo. Le dije, a ver cómo le hacemos. Pero la primera cosa que yo hago, le dije, yo oro. Primero, antes de todo, si algo pasa entre nosotros o hay una situación donde no estamos de acuerdo, es la primera cosa que yo primero oro y luego después de eso le pido perdón porque nada,
because he was wrong the whole time.
Y antes era bien difícil, yo digo, bueno, para mí, en mi lado, pedir perdón. Y aunque a veces sea o no sea mi culpa, hay veces que necesitamos que pedir perdón para que no siga la cosa. Es tiempo de pararla ahí y que no pase algo más, como te digo, más extremo o que se siga esa pelea porque no gana nadie en esa situación. So.
And Steven's really good about always apologizing, and he never gives me a chance to apologize. It's like right when I'm about to have like the nerve, or the courage to apologize, I'm like, I'm going to go in there and I'm going to be the bigger. He's like, babe, I'm sorry. I'm like, you didn't do anything. I did something, but then I don't say. I'm just like, yeah.
Y antes estábamos bien cuando nos contamos de diferencias. Antes lo que yo tenía, yo me quería sentar ahí delante de ella y hablar con ella. Y ella se enojaba porque ella cuando se enoja o cuando estamos de diferencias, ella se enojaba y se iba. Y ya no quería hablar conmigo, nomás se iba y se escondía por ahí en el cuarto, se iba a agarrar algo de comer o se salía o lo que sea. Y no quería platicar los problemas o la situación que estamos. Y ahora es al revés. Ahora ella se quiere sentar a platicar y yo no. Yo prefiero irme para mi lado y orar y a ver cómo, de ahí para adelante a ver qué pasa y pues así ya se empezó.
¿Puedo hablar yo?
Yeah.
I can't wait to hear that, friends.
Hola, dejo saludar a todos porque no he hablado. But back then when I was younger and stupid, I would try to prove that I'm very independent. And so when my daddy raised me, I don't need no man for nothing. My daddy told me, you need to learn how to do things by yourself. And so when we would argue, I would be like, I'm going to show him that I don't need him. That was my mentality. Yo siempre he sido bien independiente. Mi papá me crió que no dependiera de un hombre que me hiciera las cosas, que yo me tenía que enseñar a hacer las cosas yo misma. Y pues cuando discutíamos, yo pensaba entre mí, yo le voy a enseñar que no lo necesito. Y pues ahí ando yo enojada diciendo todo, me iba con los niños. Pero ahora las cosas, como hemos madurado en el Señor, a veces nos damos el tratamiento de silencio por un ratito y luego yo o él vamos, y yo lo que hago es le digo, dame tu mano. Y me dice, ¿por qué? ¿Qué vas a hacer? Dame tu mano.
Así le hago. No, era
ejemplo. Y le digo, vamos a orar. Y luego oramos, Señor, perdónanos si hemos faltado respeto a uno al otro. Y enséñanos dónde estamos mal. Porque si no nos enseñas, no vamos a poder arreglar las cosas. Uno no puede cambiar si no sabe lo incorrecto que está. Los errores, si no te das cuenta, no sabes cómo cambiarlo. Solo que así hemos cambiado. Ya, we were arguing over how long we've been married. We couldn't get our math right, but we've been married for 9 years. Hemos estado casados por 9 años. Yo creo que muchos pensaban que no lo íbamos a hacer, pero procedemos a la meta. Y las cosas han cambiado como marido y esposa. Ya, como dice, siempre me acuerdo de Cruz. Audrey, we're not boyfriend and girlfriend anymore. Nunca se me va a olvidar eso. Nunca. Solo que las cosas sí han cambiado.
I'm going to read something that we have here, and then we'll ask you another question. Couples who stick together understand that marriage is a sacred and solemn mystery in the eyes of God. As a result, they enter the relationship with the attitude that divorce is not an option. They understand that marriage is a long life adventure filled with triumph and defeat. Like Jesus, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, Hebrews 12:2, they press on forward the goal in both good and bad times. Our next question for you guys is, did you see a lifelong commitment modeled in your family of origin? How has your experience affected your view of this concept?
Can you translate that?
Yeah,
or did you see a good marriage modeled in your family?
La pregunta era si hemos visto como en nuestra familia un buen ejemplo como de un caso, bueno, de gente, matrimonios y casados y gente, y si nos ha ayudado o apoyado como vivimos nosotros. En parte mía, mis papás han estado casados, a lo mejor, bueno, pues ya falleció mi papá, pero a lo mejor, como yo digo, 40 o más años, y uno de casados, y para mí, como yo soy, bueno, voy a tener 30 años, y yo me crié como en una, se llama era etapa de donde como que el divorcio no era una opción en ese tiempo. Y yo, ahí como cuando me crié así, yo pensé entre mí, ¿sabes qué? Yo nunca voy a tener un divorcio. Le dije, salga como salga, yo voy a pelear por mi matrimonio y voy a salir adelante. Y esa es siempre la mentalidad que ha tenido. Y yo no sé, Adriana, pero yo no quise poner no quiero poner un mal ejemplo a mis niños, a mis hijos. Yo no quiero que miren un divorcio, yo no quiero que miren una separación. Porque pensamos en ese momento, pensamos según en lo bien para nosotros, pero no pensamos en el bien para ellos. Y le digo, muchas veces no sabemos qué lejos va esa acción que tomamos en ese momento. Y necesitamos que abrir los ojos, pero hay veces que no abrimos los ojos y nomás nos miramos, o sí los abrimos, pero nomás nos miramos unos a los otros, yo y ella, y en vez que mirar a Dios primero y usar a Dios, you know, de un ejemplo y su amor de Él, que su amor es más grande de nuestro problema que tenemos en ese momento. Y, you know, yo nomás le digo, you know, hay mucha gente que no mira el efecto que tiene. Y a veces hasta a lo mejor los niños de Malaquías y los hijos de mi hija, you know, ellos a lo mejor pueden sentir algo por la acción de que tomamos nosotros. Yo no quiero que digan, ¿sabes qué? Mis abuelos se separaron y ellos estaban bien. You know, ellos, yo quiero decir, que ellos digan, ¿sabes qué? Ellos tuvieron problemas, pero salieron adelante. You know.
What was the question again?
How did it affect you?
Yes.
Families, parents, marital, has it affected how your marriage is?
Absolutely. I have never seen two people love God so much. And in everything, they would argue, whatever it was, but one would always apologize. They'd always ask for forgiveness. They'd work things out. But most importantly, they'd always put God first. And even now, Cruz uses their relationship to tell me, you know, your mom would never do that to your dad, and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh, gosh. And it's true. Hasta Cruz usa el reflejo del matrimonio de mis papás contra mí. Me dice, tu mamá nunca le hubiera hecho eso a tu papá. Y quién sabe qué. Y I, oh, you're right.
Es que, you know, admiro mucho a mi suegra porque si ustedes estarían, como te digo, alrededor de ellos tanto tiempo como yo, se mira como, man, como ella sacrifica tanto por el pastor, y no igual como el pastor por ella. Y yo le digo a Audrey, you know, yo quiero esa relación así como tienen ellos, que a esa edad, de que yo también la quiero tener. Y necesitamos que empezar pues desde el día uno que nos casamos y seguir el camino de Dios y seguir adelante para llegar como andan ellos. Le dije, y sí, pues es difícil. Yo no puedo decir que es fácil. Y pero lo miro y es algo bello que yo pienso que para, yo lo quiero eso para todos los matrimonios, algo que tienen ellos.
Chris is making me look bad.
No, one of the things.
I love you too, suegra.
One of the things, I remember I was talking to my dad. We come through difficult times, and I've mentioned before that, you know, I look at my dad not only as my dad, but as a pastor, and he's an awesome counselor because he'll tell you if you're wrong or you're right.
Doesn't
like it is. And I remember I was having a conversation with him, and one of the, you know, probably the best advice that he's given me, and something that I now say, is that it'll pass. You know, through all the circumstances that we can find ourselves in, whether they're bad or good, but mainly in the bad, his advice to me was, is that don't worry, just pray, and it's going to pass, and that's one thing that I am able to value from our pastors. It's just that no matter how tough things will get, is if we're right on God's word, it's going to pass. It's almost just kind of like a season, you know. It's going to pass.
The good things in life are worth fighting for.
That's right.
So if you want something that'll last, you got to work for it.
The Bible says a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh, Genesis 2:24. What do you think it means to be one flesh? And you were actually talking about this in Sunday school.
Yeah.
So what do you think that means?
Leo el verso en Génesis 2:24.
Genesis 2:24.
Yeah. Donde dice que el hombre dejará a su padre y a su madre y se unirá a, pues, a su esposa. Y estaba hablando de esto en la mañana porque hemos estado hablando del sexo y es algo bien... It's awkward. Pero el estar unido al ser un... How do you say it in Spanish? One flesh?
Una carne.
Una carne. Para yo y Cruz, no nomás quiere decir físicamente, pero en la etapa que estamos ahorita, hasta aún en el espíritu, somos un espíritu casi, casi, if I'm allowed to say that. Pero a veces el Señor me dice algo y yo le comento a él y él me dice, estaba pensando lo exacto que me dijiste. Y yo, wow, you know, y siempre pasa, siempre, todo el tiempo. Y es mi mejor amigo. Si algo me pasa en el trabajo, si algo me pasa en la vida, él es el primero al que le digo. Le mando un mensaje porque es mi mejor amigo. A él le puedo decir cosas que a una otra gente no le puedo decir porque ellos no me ven. Ellos no ven la verdadera Adriana que está detrás de la puerta. Cuando la puerta se cierra, él es el que lo ve. Solo que para mí el ser una carne también es hablar sobre el espíritu y tenemos las mismas metas. Servimos al Señor juntos en todo, servimos al Señor, tenemos las mismas visiones y juntos hacemos todo hacemos junto. Y para mí eso es ser una carne.
No tan bueno, pero no, como dices, queríamos hacer una, bueno, te haces una carne y le digo yo que como de los 14 o 15 años yo ya estaba listo. Y a los 14, 15 años yo ya estaba orando a Dios. Y eso que yo me crecí católico. Y le digo a Audrey que yo sabía que había algo en mí que yo quería que era más grande que eso. Le dije, cuando yo me sentaba en mi cuarto, le dije, yo oraba. Y para alguien católico, para sentarte en tu cuarto así, nomás orar para orar, es como algo que casi no es muy común, ponle así. Y haciendo católico, le dije a Audrey, le dije, yo me sentía como que había algo, un deseo más grande, había algo más grande para mí. Y en ese tiempo, le digo a Audrey que estábamos noviando, y yo oraba, en ese tiempo yo oraba y le decía a Dios, ¿sabes qué? Yo la quiero para mí, le dije, yo quiero que sea mi esposa. Y así oré, a los 14, 15 años yo oraba, yo quiero que ella sea mi esposa, y si no me das a ella, dame a alguien igualita a ella. Y así le decía a Dios. Y Audrey le da risa porque yo le dije eso hasta antes que nos casáramos, y no, yo le dije que yo oraba, yo oraba, yo oraba, y yo le pedía su mano todo el tiempo, así, pues claro, le pedía de su mano todo el tiempo, te casas conmigo, y así, pues así nos criamos, y yo atrás de ella. Y le digo a Audrey que, me abre mis ojos a veces que tanto me ama, y a veces no lo, sí lo siento, pero hay veces que no lo miro y luego me regresa para atrás a esos tiempos. El otro día tiene un recibo, porque si te lo puedes sacar. Yo trabajé en la HEB a los 16 años, y en ese tiempo pues era cajero, ahí estaba sacando todas las comidas, las tortillas y quién sabe qué. Y ahí en la computadora podías poner mensajes y le ponías que se copiara en el recibo y salía el recibo blanco y la copia ahí, decía lo que tú le pusieras, ¿verdad? Y en ese tiempo yo le puse I love you al recibo y se lo corté porque yo miré la línea, que ahí estaba en la línea y ya venía para acá, ¿verdad? Y se metió a mi línea y ya no sé qué compró, se me hace que ni compró nada, nomás se metió para mirarme. Y no, pues que le di el recibo y nomás pues, desde ese tiempo hasta ahorita. Y tiene, se me hace...
¿Desde el 2005?
Ya, yeah, como desde el 2005, no.
Yeah, March
5th, 2005.
Oh,
I know. March 5th, 2005. No, tenía los 16 y ahorita voy a cumplir 30.
Yeah.
So tenía
2003.
Yeah, desde 2003 se me hace. Y todavía lo tiene ese recibo. No tiene nada de letras, está bien blanco porque ya se le borraron todas y todavía lo tiene hasta este momento todavía lo tiene. So. Yeah.
Okay, your stalking skills are on point. next question. I like this one. What are some practical ways you acknowledge God's authority in your home? How does the belief that He is present shape your interactions with one another?
We were laughing at this earlier.
You
want to
translate?
No, I don't want to translate it. Let me answer real quick. Let me translate it. What does it say?
What are some practical ways you can acknowledge God's authority in your home? How does the belief...
Okay, hold on. ¿Qué son unas maneras prácticas que puedes reconocer que Dios está en tu casa?
La autoridad
de Dios está en tu casa.
And how does the belief that He is present shape your interactions with one another?
We were laughing. I swear, I was like, I'm gonna say this. And I told him, when we argue, I have to remember that God is there. And I tell him, I have to hide my crazy, and I gotta be respectful. And I do. I bite my tongue a lot, and I don't say what I want to say because I'm like, There's life in the tongue. You can give life or you can take it. And I don't want to be responsible of killing my marriage over something that I said because I was mad.
Yep.
And so I have to acknowledge and I got to say, look, crazy, you got to go hide somewhere because she can't come out right now. And so, but we always put God first. We went to go look for a car for him the other day. And in the middle of the parking lot, I'm like, let's pray. So we're holding hands in the middle of the parking lot, and I'm like, God, if this is your will, let it happen. We walked away. We did not regret it. Ran paperwork and everything, but we didn't regret it because we always put God first, and God didn't let it happen. And so we acknowledge that God is always there, and we put Him first in everything. Before we make any choice, you know, I want to move north because it snows. I don't see snow. I like snow. And so I want to move so bad. And I'm like, but the church.
Yeah.
But children's ministry.
What about the children?
We can't go. You know, and we put God first all the time.
La pregunta era, ¿cómo sabes tú o cómo sientes tú que está la autoridad de Dios en tu casa? Y para mí es porque no cambiamos las personas que estemos aquí que las personas que estemos en la casa. Y no, tenemos respeto de todo, de la presencia de Dios, no nomás aquí, te digo, y es en la casa también. Y hasta lo miro en mis hijos, el ejemplo que les ponemos a ellos. Y no, ponle que corren y se portan mal y todo, pero la fe que tienen ellos tan chiquitos, sabemos que la autoridad de Dios está no nomás aquí, está en la casa porque ahí practicamos también lo que practicamos aquí. So,
something that we do at our house, it's like, I mean, it's religion. I mean, it's just, we just do it. It's natural. Is that we pray over our food. Like, it doesn't matter. We pray over our food. It doesn't matter. I'm always getting on to the kids. And my son, for some reason, I have to go down the line. The second one, Gio, he's been forgetting to do it. I don't know why. And so I've been having to get on to him about that. And I'm just like, do you know what it took, you know, for us to even be able to put food on this table and who's provided it for you? And it baffles me that, you know, Caleb and Charlotte are just, I've trained them to, they're just like, I mean, they don't even know really what they're saying. I mean, Caleb's like, Papa, Grandma, me, food, and then, you know, he has his little hands up, you know, and it's so cute, and it's like we've trained him, and you know, in Charlotte, you know, with her little purr that she does, and just simple things like that is just to remind them that, hey, you know, God has authority in our house. And, you know, other things, you know, our kids aren't allowed to watch certain movies or anything like that. We don't even watch certain movies. You know, if something we know is coming up on TV or whatever, we fast forward through it. I know it's lame and it's not cool and I can't believe you do that, but we do. And we feel convicted, you know, like, we'll fast forward through any scene that we know isn't appropriate. And I mean, there's some good TV out there, but you know, we feel convicted for it. And when that right there, even that shows that there's authority in this house, you know, that we won't even watch movies, you know, because we don't want to hurt God by what we do in our home and, you know, a home that He's provided for us, you know.
Another way that we know that God is an authority in our house is just listening to the kids talk.
Yeah.
It's hilarious. Mm-hmm. Malachi, God is watching. And there's just both of them, you know, you look at them so small, but the highlight of his week is children's ministry.
My kids too, they love, Gio cries if I can't make it or something goes on with me or I'm sick or something, and I'm like, see, you're going to have to take Gio because he will not let me have the end of it, you know. I want to go to church. I'm like, calm down.
And so, you know, I want to make church fun for them and for all the kids because I don't want them to grow up and be like, I don't want to go to church. It's boring. Because church was boring for us. We were falling asleep and we were hitting each other and doing bad stuff, getting the church pinch. But I notice it with them. You say something hurts, Malachi, let me pray. Be healed in the name of Jesus, you know. And that's how I know that, you know what, we're doing okay. I hope it always stays like that. Don't get me wrong.
You know, the fact that our kids come up to the altar call, and my son's 9, and he's, you know, things that they're learning in children's ministry or watching mommy and daddy come up to the altar, and, you know, and they're little. It just, my son, like, went up here to go pray for his brother. Nobody asked him to. And when, you know, he was crying about it, his heart hurt for his brother. And I asked him when he came back to the bench, I'm like, why are you crying? And he's just like, oh, you know, I'm crying because I want my brother to come home. That's what he told me. And, you know, Gio wants Noah to come home. And it's just from seeing mommy and daddy, you know, come to the altar. And then, you know, Noah, we were out of town and he came up to the altar. And it's just example of showing authority in the house that we're not afraid to pray. You know, this is who we are. You know, we love, we worship God. And that's all we're about is God. You know, if it's not about God, we don't want it. It doesn't belong here.
I think we'll start doing Malachi as God's watching you.
God's watching you.
But it takes a really high level of commitment just to be in a marriage. And I said it on our first sermon that we had, that God has to be centered in our marriage. You know, we're two different people. Two creatures. But with God in the center, everything is evolved around God. And if you circle it, both people would just circle around the center of God. You create a circle, and it has God right in the middle. And if you're going round and round and round, it's almost like if you're creating a shield, that as long as you have God in the middle, nothing can penetrate that. So no matter if we're going through good times or bad times, and I say this a lot because going through the bad times is really tough, but going through the bad times is what molds us. It's what creates us. It's what grows us. You know, I believe that we can't get to the next level, whether it's our ministry, our marriage, we can't get to the next level without going through that hard time. It'll make us who we are. It'll make us who what God wants us to be. And from then on, it's a level of commitment. And it's a commitment with God. But I want to invite you all to the altar today. You all rise. I want to thank Audrey and Cruz for joining us today.
Estaba leyendo en la Biblia donde dice que el Señor durmió a Adán para sacarle la costilla, porque aún el Señor está consciente que a veces las cosas nos duelen. Y lo durmió para que la mujer, the extracting of the woman, or what would make the woman, would cause pain. Para no causar dolor, lo durmió. Y como esposa, nuestro trabajo es de edificar a nuestros maridos, de apoyarlos en todo. No siempre estoy de acuerdo con Cruz, pero mi trabajo como esposa es de apoyarlo. Primeramente vamos a orar, y aunque no me guste, pero si estás bien tú, lo vamos a hacer, porque ese es mi trabajo como esposa. Yo tengo que asegurarme de lo que yo le digo sea para edificarlo, porque la Biblia dice que con la lengua podemos quitar la vida o podemos dar vida. Y yo no quiero ser la causa por la cual mi matrimonio falló porque yo estaba enojada y dije algo que no debería de haber dicho. Solo que no, como esposa, nuestro trabajo es de apoyar y de no causar dolor. Solo que aún Dios, cuando nos sacó, nos formó, durmió al hombre para que no doliera. Solo que nuestro trabajo como marida es, como esposa, es de apoyar, de hacer una ayuda idónea y de dar amor, de dar afección, afecto, de dar palabra y de dar vida. So que that's all right.
Amen. You need to remember, you just have to stay committed. Commitment is love. Love is work. Work is commitment. We've got to get through the hard times. And the same thing with God. And like my pastor told me, it'll pass. And God will be glorious. Remember, God has already won the war.
Yes. Yeah.
In the name of Jesus.
Gloria,
we have to claim it in His name. And He's already won. So los quiero invitar al púlpito, si quieren orar, por favor. I want to invite you all to come and pray. Show your level of commitment tonight towards God. Show Him how committed you are with Him. Express your love, express your need with God. We want blessings from God. What are we giving back to God? What are we giving to Him? ¿Qué le damos para atrás al Señor? Queremos todas sus bendiciones, pero ¿qué le voy a dar yo a Él? Dele tu amor. Tu alma, dale tu presencia. Lord Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father, for today, Father, Lord Jesus. Lord, I pray for all these people that are here tonight, Father, Lord Jesus. Lord, I ask that you hear and ask that you see their level of commitment that they were here today, Father, to hear your word, Father, Lord Jesus. Encourage them, Father.
Que sean libres, libres, libres de toda cosa mala que los oprime. Dios mío, queremos vivir vidas saludables, Señor mío, para poder tener un motivo grande por lo cual agradecerte cada día. Ahora estamos para salir de este lugar, te pido que nos ayudes y nos bendigas, Padre Santo. Salir, Dios, que podamos, Señor, nosotros, Señor, llevar gozo en el corazón. Y un deseo por trabajar más, Señor, para apoyar la obra, para apoyar a nuestros hijos, para apoyar la juventud y para alcanzar a otros que no han sido alcanzados, Padre. Para gloria en santo nombre, bendiga este departamento y los líderes también, Padre. En el nombre glorioso de Jesús lo pido y a ti la gloria doy. Amén y amén.
Amén,
amén.
Amén, thank you. El único anuncio que tengo, el domingo otra vez nos vamos a tener culto en la tarde. Vamos a ir a Dallas, al concierto que es gratis. Los jóvenes padres, si quieren ir a apoyar, vengan. Va a ser, va a tener Chris Tomlin, él sale en el radio, Lecrae, Switchfoot y Mercy Me. Ellos siempre cantan canciones de alabanza cristiano y van a predicar también. Y también lo pueden ver aquí también por la computadora si la iglesia quiere. Pero es otra vez, es gratis y ya después el culto de domingo en la mañana nos vamos, agarramos, vamos, yo creo que vamos a servir pizzas acá con los jóvenes y nos vamos para ya para darles, nos vamos a gozar y le vamos a dar toda la gloria al Señor ese día. Ok. Sí. Empieza a las 5 el concierto y no sé hasta cuándo, pero va a estar en el estadio de los Cowboys.
¿O te jugaron el Super Bowl hace 4 años?
Sí.
¿Eres el deporte?
Hey, amen. It's going to be filled with a bunch of Christian people.
¿Cuánto quisiera conocer ese estadio?
Sí,
amen. Vamos en el. Nos llamamos el van. ¿Eh? Yeah. Pues si quieren apoyen a los jóvenes otra vez, es gratis, nomás si quieren ayudar con la gente para con el camino, vamos a necesitar ride y carros, pero gracias otra vez, hermanos, por su tiempo. Dios los bendiga.
Amén, amén, gloria a Dios.